All right, everyone, welcome back. Previous video, we got an introduction to Sequencer. We talked about shots, we talked about the power of Sequencer and why it's so flexible and how we can move shots around and dive into shots and start working inside of them. We enabled our cinematic viewport, so we got an overview of Sequencer as a whole. Up next, what we're gonna do is start actually creating our cinematic. So let's go ahead and continue. Let's go make sure that we're in the master sequence. You can go to the content browser, double-click master, then go to the sequence editor, make sure you're in the master sequence. I'm going to select all of the shots in here and delete them, actually, because we're going to start from scratch here. And let's go ahead and let's go to the content browser real quick. Let's take shot 2 and shot 3 by holding control and selecting them, and let's delete those, because we're going to duplicate shot 1 a little bit later once we've added content to it. So let's go to sequencer again and make sure that we're at frame 0. Let's add a shot. Let's add shot 01 back. So we have shot 01. And you can adjust the ending marker. Right now it's fine where it is, actually. You can probably leave it wherever you want, because we're going to adjust it a little bit later. Let's jump into shot 01, actually, though. Let's start working inside of it. For this one, we're going to stretch the frame out, the frame marker out a little bit. A quick shortcut, if you hold control and press G, that'll bring up a go-to. I'm going to say frame 400. Go to frame 400. You can then press this key here to set the playback into the current position, or you can press the key on the keyboard, the same key on the keyboard, the closed bracket. So like so, just so we have enough room to kind of work with, because I don't know how long the scene's going to be yet. All right, so we have 0 to 400. Okay, so the first thing that we're going to need to do is add a character to the level and position him where we want, and then we're going to add him to Sequencer so that we can control him through Sequencer. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to maximize the level viewport here for a second, because we're going to be working inside of it for the most part. I have two master sequences in here for some reason. I shouldn't, but let me delete one of them. I think I added one by accident in between videos. Just noticed that. So let's go ahead and add the character that we're going to be using. He's going to be inside of the Infinity Blade Adversaries and Enemy folder. There's a ton of enemies in here. We're only going to be focused on two. We're going to be focused on the enemy bear and the enemy master grunt. Let's add the enemy master grunt first. So I'm going to double click, open that up. And inside the level here, we're going to kind of position him somewhere like right here. So he's kind of like looking at this statue. And then later we're going to have our bear come in through the door, and they're going to have a fight scene right here. So let's take our SK master grunt, left click, and drag and drop him into the level. Might take a little bit longer for yours to load the textures in, but once he's in, he should be looking similar to this. And before we position him, though, he has some weapons, so we're going to add those as well. I'm going to take this weapon here, just left-click and drag that in. And over in the world outliner, I'm going to search for grunt, so that we have the weapon and the character. Now, we want to attach this weapon to this character, so when we animate this character, the weapon goes along for the ride. Before we can do that, though, we need to make sure that we have the weapon selected, and we need to set its mobility setting to movable so that it can move around in the scene. Once we've done that, we can then take the weapon, left click, drag, and drop it on top of the grunt. It's going to ask us where we want to attach it. Fortunately, this character has some weapon bones that we can attach it to. So we have weapon L here and weapon R. Let's do the weapon L first. So I'm going to select this. That's going to attach it to our character there. And the transform widget's off a little bit, so I'm going to deselect it and reselect it. So now we can position the weapon in his hand a little bit better than that. So I'm going to press E to go into rotation mode, and then just grab this arc and kind of twist it upwards like so. And this is not going to be perfect, but I'm just going to try and get through it quickly. Let's see. Need to twist it a little bit more. So around this arc, something like that. Like this. Feel free to spend as much time on this as you'd like to make sure it is right in his hand, but for now I think this is going to be good. I'm going to press W to go into translation and just move it down. I'm going to turn grid snapping off so I can get a little bit more precise control. Press E one more time, just rotate it. So something like that. That looks good to me. Looks like it's in his hand. Not bad. Looks good. Okay, I'm going to select it again and go back into translation mode with W. I'm going to hold Alt now on my keyboard, grab this red arrow, drag it to the left to drag out a copy. That's already going to be attached to our character, so I'm going to deattach it real quick. Or detach it. Deattach it. That's not a word. Detach it. Let's drag this up to the top. So to detach it from our character, because we're going to reattach it now. just by dragging and dropping it back on our grunt, so that we can assign it to weapon R now. And just like we did before, I'm going to deselect it and reselect it so that I can adjust the transform to put it in his hand. I'm going to hit E and rotate it around. Something like this. Let's rotate it on this arc. No, not that arc. Let's rotate it like this. This arc is the one we need. Nope. So let's just rotate it around. W to move it. Like I said, it's not going to be perfect, but get out of here. I think that's good for now. That's close enough. I'm happy with it. Hopefully you are too. Character's floating in the air. That looks pretty rad. We don't want him in the air for our scenes. We're going to plop him down to the ground. So I'm going to select him now. Hit W to go back into translation mode. Grab this arrow and just plop him down. And I'm going to move him forward a little bit. Fly down here. Make sure that he's on the ground. Hit E to rotate him. Something like this. Looks good to me. He's a little bit clipping into the ground, but I think that's fine. I could probably rotate him a little bit more, too. So he's going to be looking at the statue, not necessarily standing like this. He'll be in a sitting pose to start our scene. So we have our character set. Let's go ahead and add him to Sequencer now. So I'm going to go to the Sequencer tab. Make sure that you're in Shot 01. Click the Add button, Actor to Sequencer, Add SK Master Grunt. And when we click this, it's going to add it to Sequencer. It's going to give us a couple tracks, one for transform, one for animation. Let's go ahead and add an animation first. So I'm going to click this button right here, Add Animation. Animation that we're going to use is called Intro. So I'm going to go ahead and choose that. And it's going to position our character seated on the ground. Like so, but it's not facing the statue like we want. So I'm going to press E and rotate him around, like so. So that he's kind of sitting on the ground. Something like this. We could move him a little bit more if we wanted to. Keep selecting this transparent fog plane here. What's the key for that? Is it T? If I press T, is it Control T? Which one is it? It's one of them. Control T to not select translucent objects. Anyway, so what I wanted to show real quick, we've positioned our character. If we scrub ahead, what's going to happen is he's going to go back to his default position. He's going to take the transform in which that he was added to Sequencer. So we added him to Sequencer and then moved him. We need to initialize his position inside of our sequence here. So I'm going to have to rotate him again, but I just wanted to show that, that you got to add a transform first before you make any movements, if you add an animation. Otherwise, it's going to reset back to its default position. So I'm going to rotate him around again. And let's move him over. I can hit Control and the tilde key to switch between translation between world and local. So let's do that, something like this. Let's see how it looks. Looks good to me. So that's where he's going to be, sitting, something like that. So let's go to the transform track. Let's click this button here, this little button here. So add a key for the current position. So now if we scrub, it's not going to change anything because we've initialized his position. So if we scrub all the way ahead, what's going to happen is he's going to stand up and turn around, which looks good. And we're almost done. Let's add a camera now and frame up this shot. So there's a couple ways we can add cameras. I'll show you the first way here is by going to the Modes panel. You could search for camera. There's a couple different options. There's a camera here, which is the default camera actor, but there's a special camera all the way at the bottom called a cinematic camera actor. There's other options in here that we may talk about a little bit later as we get on in the series. We may add a rail shot or a crane shot. We'll talk about those a little bit later. But we're going to take this cinematic camera angle because it has additional properties that we can use for cinematic purposes. So I'm going to left click, drag and drop this into our scene here. And it gives us a little viewport, the view perspective of this camera. We could use our widgets here to kind of move it around, press E, rotate it around, and frame up our shot using just this little viewport here, but that's not pretty helpful. One of the ways that I like to do this is to take our camera here, right click on it, and go into pilot mode. So if we go into pilot mode, now we can move the camera, but we're also looking from the perspective of the camera. So we can really get in there, frame up our shot, holding down the right mouse button, using the WASD keys, using the mouse wheel to speed up or slow down movement speed. So we can really get in here and frame up our shot like we want. Because we're going to want to do something like this. And this is actually going to be our shot. Sometimes I'll preview shots before I actually create them in Sequencer to kind of get an idea of what looks cool, what I want to do for the particular shot. So for this particular shot, what we want to do is kind of start back here and kind of push in on our character as he stands up. So I'm going to frame up our shot. Before we do that, there's a couple other things we could do. We could press G on our keyboard, hide all the editor icons again, so we can really get an idea of what it will look like. Before we add our camera to Sequencer, let's make some changes to the settings. So if we go over to the details panel here where the camera's selected, there's some look at tracking, so we could track actors as they move around in our scene. There's some film back settings. We click this drop down, you can change the film back settings, such as Super 35, 16, Super 8, etc. Some lens settings that you can change. Feel free to experiment with these. There's focus settings, focal length, aperture, etc. Probably the ones that we're going to be focused on the most are the film back settings and the focus settings for this tutorial series. So let's change the film back settings. You could use any one you want, but one we're going to use a custom one, actually. I'm just going to set these manually to 20 by 12. So something like this. And if we expand our cinematic viewport, we're not going to see anything just yet, but we're going to get like a letterbox style setup. Doesn't show it here because our viewport is stretched out, but it's going to give us a letterbox style format. And it'll show that in the cinematic viewport here in a moment. So let's frame up our shot. I want to kind of get the statue in there, kind of a low angle, something like this. Looks cool. And our character is currently not in focus, so let's go down to the focus settings. There's a focus method. We can manually set it, or we can track actors just like we can with the look at tracking. We can manually enter a value here, or we can use this slider here to kind of get into the right range. You should see our viewport start to come into and out of focus here. Probably too high the values. There we go. So somewhere around 520, it looks like he's in focus. We could also use this eyedropper here. If we click this option, we can go over to our level viewport and just pick where we want to sample from. So we could click this and say sample from here, just like that. So our camera's set up. Let's actually add it to Sequencer now. So I'm going to click the Add button, Actor to Sequencer, Add Cinematic Camera Actor. And before we do anything, let's add a transform for this the start of our scene here. So let's go to Transform. And before we click the plus sign, we can also press the S button on our keyboard. That will add the location, rotation, and scale. You could press Shift plus W for just location, Shift plus E for just rotation, or Shift plus R for just scale if you want to do those individually, or you can press S to do it for all three. So we've initialized the position of our camera. It's not going to go anywhere, which is fine. As we scrub ahead in our scene here, we're probably going to want to move our camera. So what we'll do is just scrub ahead to the end of our scene here, something like 277. You can use the arrow keys to step through on your keyboard. So we'll go to like 277. We're still piloting our camera at this point. I'm going to hold the right mouse button and just use the WASD keys as well as E to kind of position a shot of our character like so. And let's go ahead and press S for this, something like this. So we have some camera movement that should kind of push forward like so. Now we've told our camera, we've created our camera, we've told our camera that we want it to move, etc., but we haven't told this shot to use that particular camera just yet. And we can do that with a camera cuts track. So if I go and bring back our cinematic viewport, we're not going to see anything in there just yet. In fact, we can fly around in it too, just like we can a regular viewport. But we need to tell our shot here to use a camera cuts track and use this particular camera. So let's go to the Add button, and we're going to add a camera cut track. And then we can click this button here to specify the camera that we want to use for this shot, making sure that we're at frame zero. So And now our cinematic viewport updates to reflect our scene. So now we can kind of scrub ahead and see our scene. So that looks pretty cool. We can play this now. And that's actually going to do it for this video. We're going to pause here, actually, because in the next scene, what we're going to do is cut somewhere around here, and we're going to shoot this from the front now. So we'll shoot it a little bit differently. If we unpilot this, we'll keep our cinematic viewport. So that's what we're going to do in the next video, is shoot so that we're shooting it from the front. So our character is kind of out of focus here, which is perfectly fine because we're not going to be using the end part of this scene anyway. So that's going to do it for this video. We have our first shot in. We've created a character that has animation. We've created a camera with camera movement and assigned it. We've adjusted the film back settings and focus settings. Done quite a bit in this video. So we'll pause here. We'll pick it back up in the next video where we add another character, add more cameras, and continue on with our scene. Thank you guys for watching. We'll see you then.